My name is Garrett Long. I work as the Director of Agriculture here at Troon Vineyard. And today I'm here with Andrew Beattie, our biodynamic consultant. Andrew, we broke ground on a brand new vegetable garden earlier this year. We got started a little bit late because we had a wet spring. We've got some heavy clay soils. Took a while to get in there, but eventually we dissed up the ground. We bedded up our garden, got our irrigation installed, got our greenhouse built. You know, we've had some challenges here, as I think anybody will in a first-year garden.
Sure.
What challenges have we been working through?
Well, the first challenge is that the reason why we chose that location for gardening or another layer of production here at Troon beyond vineyards is because the soil are extremely poor. So we chose that area to use as a demonstration of how do we use biodynamic farming to improve a very poor soil.
Yeah.
Great water holding capacity, but poor soils. So the first challenge, building organic matter, which I looking at your recent reports, I forget the percentage, but 50% more organic matter just in the last 6 months in that area. The list of challenges in the first year garden are extremely long. But the main thing to set you guys up to be successful is just focusing on that organic matter.
Yeah.
Freeing up those soils.
That's right. So we spread a ton of compost in there. The first way is actually
not literally one ton, but
yeah.
50 tons was our goal.
In about a half acre. Yeah. Over the course of a year. So we added a bunch of compost. That was the first thing, was just adding physical organic matter. And with the compost comes all of the life, all of the microbial life that will also help inoculate those soils. I mean, the history of that field specifically, and one of the reasons why it wasn't chosen for planting vineyard or anything else was because it's not desirable for vines, but it is okay for vegetables. So like you said, kind of getting organic matter in there and that microbial inoculation, actually getting those soils living again, was sort of our first step. And we're also using the biodynamic preparations down there as well, which we're you know, so in the spring, our goal for this next spring will be to use preparation 500, right? Or sorry, in the fall, excuse me.
Right. We'll do one application in the fall, coupled with barrel compost.
Yep.
Then at each, you mentioned that the garden is developed as individual 2.5 foot wide by 100 foot-ish beds. So each of those beds will have its own rotation of crops.
Yep.
And within that rotation will be applications of 500 when we, let's say we finish a bean harvest, we'll mulch the beans in place, we'll apply 500 onto that.
Yep.
We might even add additional preps to that soil, use our cultivation techniques to again incorporate crop residue and build organic matter. So and I was telling Craig, the GM at Troon today, that the complexity and the diversity of every biodynamic farming system is uppermost important.
Yeah.
And within that complex system or diverse system, the most diverse individual organ of that system, so to speak, would be your annual horticultural system.
Yeah, and so we're, you mentioned crop rotations. You know, we are, in addition to using compost to try to increase organic matter, the other thing I think about is a real principle of soil health is just keeping a living plant in the ground all year round. And so hitting our crop rotations, timing the seeding of our vegetables or the seeding of our winter cover crops well in advance, having that plan, and then be able to just keep a living plant in the ground all year round as part of that crop rotation. So can you talk a little bit about that rotation and sort of moving between legumes and root crops and fruit crops and all of that?
So vegetables are extremely heavy feeders, hard on the soil, remove a lot of nutrients, remove a lot of organic matter. So using a rotation of crops, we try and minimize that uptake of nutrients from the soil. So, you know, a heavy feeder, so to speak, tomatoes, something like that, will, once that is finished, we've finished harvesting all the tomatoes, we'll cultivate the crop residue back into the soil, then we'll, to rebuild, let's just use nitrogen as an example, to rebuild what we've taken out of that soil, we can replenish with a legume. We can do like a fava bean or broad bean, as we say.
Another thing we do is clover in our winter cover crop.
Sure, yeah, mixing in those is ideal to, that's just again using nitrogen as an example, but replenishing that through a diverse approach to that individual bed. So the diversity of that approach in not only building soil health, but maintaining that soil health is the cornerstone of biodynamic horticulture, where we don't just simply take out. Our goal is not just harvesting tomatoes from this bed. Our goal is to, one, have a healthy, nutritious harvest, but also prepare that soil with a long-term view of many years.
Yeah. So speaking of that, thinking about the sort of extractive nature of agriculture in general, when you harvest those vegetables and you take them to market or you sell them here at this farm stand here at Troon that we'll offer out to our community, you are inevitably taking away those nutrients that those plants use to make the vegetables, make the fruit, the carrots, whatever it might be, and you're taking that away. So you're talking about using cover crops, using compost, using biodynamic preps to replenish those nutrients. The nature of a biodynamic farm is to limit those outside inputs. Can you talk to us a little bit about the challenges, especially in the beginning, of trying to put back what you take out as well as continually build soil fertility?
Sure. So you mentioned a closed loop system with off-farm inputs. That's our goal. Are we going to get to that goal? Likely not. But in our approach to that, replenishing soil nutrients, we are not just taking the short-term view of extracting, you know, a harvest for economic return. Yeah. We're actually being considerate in using all the tools of our biodynamic toolbox for that long-term view of, and you mentioned organic matter and microbial life, so soil, three realms, the mineral, the organic, the living. Well, in the vegetable garden, that area, the one thing we do have is mineral. Mm-hmm. We've got that, that's established.
All of the soil.
What we're trying to do now is bring the organic and the living in balance with that mineral realm.
Yeah.
And that's, you can do that through through many tools, biodynamic tools and organic tools, to reduce your off-farm input, hopefully to zero, but I haven't seen a biodynamic farm with zero off-farm inputs. Not yet.
You know, I don't want to only talk about the challenges here. I want to talk about things that are going well. But one other challenge to point to has been the impact of incorporating wildlife. You know, I think about inviting in wildlife in the forms of raptors that help eat the ground squirrels and the gophers that would take out our trees or vines. I think about inviting in beneficial insects and pollinators, predators. But we also have invited in all the migratory waterfowl. We've had Canadian geese come in from the pond, which is just a stone's throw from our new garden. Twice now, we've planted a row of lettuce and come back the very next morning and seen 90% of the lettuce plants just munched down. And so, you know, we've tried to take a couple of approaches, like using row cover to protect the lettuce plants when they're young, both from insects and from birds.
Sure.
And the geese seem to have got right under there. You know, there's geese poop on our bed the next morning and no lettuce plants remaining. How can we create a farm with, you know, at least 10 acres of biodiversity reserve habitat we've created and know that we're going to accept some loss, know that there's going to be challenges? How do we actually work with nature in an effective way?
Well, you have to be, to be successful in horticulture, you have to be resigned to the fact that some of it is going to fail. And geese are going to show up and be somewhat of a pain within that system. That doesn't mean that those two systems can't live in harmony. But, I mean, we were just trying to think of an example of how to mitigate just those, you know, the geese, using that as the example here, is maybe we plant a catch crop that they like on the other side of the pond.
Sure.
Or maybe we find out as we go through these seasons that there are some crops that they really just, garlic or something like that, that they really just avoid with a passion, then perhaps there is a way of incorporating that preventative crop or natural barrier between your vegetable garden and the habitat of your neighbors. So there's but you can't get around the fact that it can be very disheartening at times losing crops, but that is what will make for a very resilient and level-headed farmer. Because that's how it is.
This is something I've actually learned from you, something I really admire. You know, you and I have worked together for more than 10 years on several different biodynamic farms, this being our third project specifically. Something I really admire about you, Andrew, is that you are level-headed and you, I don't want to say don't take things too seriously. You're a serious farmer, you're a professional, but you don't let these kinds of things get you down. And by comparison, I think I let myself get very stressed out and take it as a failure, take it as a personal failure, or take it as a failure on behalf of my leadership that I'm letting my team down when they've worked so hard to plant out those lettuce plants and we come back the next day and they're gone. How do you personally, how have you found balance? How have you found humor in this farming?
It's all in the diversity. If that's how you're going to have, or how anybody can have a successful biodynamic business, whether it be primarily viticulture like Troon or a biodynamic wheat farmer in the Central Valley, if you can build diversity within that system, you're not just more, your revenue stream is spread over a wider area, is more resilient to crop failure from geese or whatever. It's also a chance to, over a long-term view again, create a system that's balanced, diverse, and that through that balance and diversity will be inherently more resilient to our pressing challenge at the moment, which is climate change. Because that's, because every building balance within the three realms of soil, the microbial, the living, the organic, the mineral, everything from that balance will then be built off of throughout your farming, you know, industry and property as a whole.
So speaking of diversity, you travel all over the world to consult on biodynamic farms in Slovakia, in China, in Southern California, in Tennessee, very different climates, soil types, and cultures, frankly. Has your exposure to different farming systems provided this, you know, back to sort of how do you get by, what gets you out of bed in the morning, what keeps you going? Is it that diversity of farming systems and cultures and experiences that really gets you out of bed and keeps you in this business?
My kids get me out of bed before farming, but it's the more diverse you can make your system, the more diverse I can make my business, the more resilient those farms will be, and the more resilient, just from, you know, my own business entity, the more resilient and successful that will be. So it's all, you can always go back to bringing those three realms of soil into balance and build off of that.
So we've talked a lot about the challenges of this first year garden. What's going well?
Taking the first step is the, and it sounds corny or whatever the terminology should be, but you take the first step, you're on your mission, you're on your route, and it will turn around extremely fast.
Yeah.
And we can see that just in that anecdotal analysis of organic matter, that if you focus on those three realms, and I will always dovetail back to that, if you focus on there, you will have an extremely successful, resilient, and productive, nutritious garden.
Yeah.
But what's gone well this year is you managed to grow an extremely diverse crop of nutritious fruit crops, root crops, legumes, salads, greens,
flowers.
It's a very diverse landscape, a commercial greenhouse that, in my mind, is an extremely successful first year.
Yeah.
And has there been failures? Well, like all the years to come, there will be geese just over the horizon.
One of the successes I've noticed is our sunflower crop. It's a row that's right in the middle of the garden. Our assistant winemaker, Hannah, said that it makes her so happy to go down there and just see a wall of sunflowers. I personally love sunflowers. They're very beautiful, and that aesthetic beauty, it actually reminds me of another mentor of mine and a coworker, Alan York, sadly passed away. But one of the things that has stuck with me from the very first couple of months that I met Alan was he said that beauty is what gets him out of bed. To create a beautiful, diverse system, color, different textures, animals, plants, people, everything interacting, that that beauty is actually really important to a farming system, even if that doesn't make you a direct, you know, return on revenue.
It is a patchwork quilt.
Yeah.
So that both in a beautiful, well-made, well-stitched together patchwork quilt, or a patchwork within a biodynamic farming system.
Yeah.
Equally beautiful.
Those sunflowers definitely inspire me to go down there and keep working hard despite the failures. And really, we are harvesting quite a bit. I mean, here in our new farm stand, we just completed construction on this a week ago. We added the stain to it. We got the walk-in cooler fired up. And just in time to start chilling down these vegetables that we're bringing out of the garden right now in the walk-in, we've got pickling cucumbers, we've got zucchini, beets, carrots, peas, lettuce, basil, more to come, lots of flowers, sunflowers, etc. And these vegetables we'll be able to offer to our customers. You know, our hope is to be able to serve not just as a hub for education about biodynamics and really good quality wine, but also to be able to feed our community these good nutritious vegetables. And so our hope is that people will come here. Maybe they've heard of Troon, who knows what brings them in, but they can sit down, enjoy a flight, a nice tasting, revel in the education that our incredible tasting room educators can provide, and maybe be surprised to find that we're also selling vegetables and eventually fruit. We're also planting a ton of fruit trees this coming winter time.
A hundred?
About 100 fruit trees, exactly. Really in a permaculture style food forest. It's going to be a diverse planting. And so give us 3 to 5 years before we're actually harvesting fruit off those trees, but we'll also be selling those fruits here in the farm stand and working with local chefs, restaurants to create these value-added goods like ferments, like kimchi and sauerkraut and things like that. With the fruit, we can eventually make jams and fruit butters and things. We can make hot sauces from our chilies. Tons of fermentation is definitely on the goal. And we'll be able to work with them by providing the vegetables. They can turn it into a value-added product, and we could market it here in our farm stand alongside some fresh fruits and veggies, something that I'm really excited about.
Well, that is an extremely long list of produce for your farm shop.
This is just our spring crops. Our summer crops are still to come, really. We're going to be harvesting tomatoes soon. We're also, I forgot to mention, the chamomile flowers, which we're growing in the vegetable garden. That'll be part of our biodynamic preparation 503. What else have we got coming? The chilies may not yield anything for us, but we got some chilies in the ground. And we've just spent the last couple of days making a plan for our fall and winter garden, not just cover cropping and building that soil health like we talked about earlier, but also growing some crops through the winter, like garlic, fava beans, some brassica plants like cauliflower, broccoli, radish, turnips, rutabaga, kohlrabi. All of these are coming up, and they're crops that are what they're going to spend the winter in the ground.
Exactly.
Yeah. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, listening to the last few minutes of you discussing the garden and the farm shop, you can see where the complexity within this biodynamic system is not in the vineyard. These are perennials. They are a low input plant, whereas your vegetable garden is an extremely high input and highly organized out there. And that's how you'll be successful.
Yeah.
It's being organized.
Yeah.
And focusing on soil health as a whole.
What do you look forward to? Talked about the challenges, talked about the successes. What do you, you know, you've been working with Troon since 2017, 2018?
We were just talking about that this morning. It's been
5 years.
A number of years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you've seen, I would imagine, pretty incredible growth over that time. What do you expect for the next 5 years?
Well, certainly just one more season down there in the vegetable garden, you'll see a remarkable difference of soil health being reflected in crop and plant health within that garden. It will not be 5 years down there. This is one season focusing on those three realms. But the long-term view of this Troon as a living organism, you know, as biodynamic species, the farm, being a living organism, when you spoke of the last 5 years, we're only just in that first grade, the third grade of school. We have many more years where you can continue to add diversity and complexity and resiliency to that system.
Yeah.
And if you start with a solid foundation like you guys have, then using education as a comparison, if you start with a Waldorf kindergarten for your kids, you set them up well.
Yeah.
So now that you guys are set up with your foundation, now you guys get to do the fun stuff.
Yeah.
Which is building that complexity and that resiliency and that diversity.
Yeah.
Within your own system.
So if we're in the third grade here, we're just breaking down on the vegetable or breaking ground on the vegetable garden. Yeah. We were in second grade, so to speak, when we brought animals into the system. Something I'm looking forward to in terms of our livestock and poultry program is growing that. We just bred our sheep this last winter for the first time. Yeah. We went from 8 mamas to 20 sheep altogether, had 12 lambs, and we will do another round of breeding this winter. And if we have a similar growth, we'll more than double our flock. Maybe we'll have 50, 60 sheep altogether.
That's a lot.
Next year, it's a lot. And it'll give us a lot of opportunities to integrate those animals throughout the whole farm and actually really start grazing the vineyards in earnest. You know, we're finishing this replant right now. So we have a lot of young vines that were timid to graze. But as those vines get into that 3, 4, 5 year old phase and are tolerant of a little bit of browsing during that dormant season, we'll be able to more fully incorporate animals. We'll be able to add a second mobile chicken coop to the rotation, have more eggs to also be able to sell here at the farm stand. At what age will we be when we bring cows into this biodynamic farm?
Well, like growing a plant, you have to plant the idea. So I indicated to Craig that's, you know, we start small animals, we start chickens, we got a medium sheep, we got a large cows.
Mm-hmm.
It's a necessity for every biodynamic farm. Got shot down in flames. But once we cultivate that idea over time, then adding the ruminant effects of cattle into a biodynamic farming system can be one of the most important parts of a system. It doesn't work in every system, and the good thing about biodynamics is you have to be pragmatic about it.
Yeah.
Because we have this ideal view of a self-sustaining, zero off-farm input, ethical, ecological farming system, well, that's the goal. And there's many steps ahead of getting to that goal. And not all of those individual parts of that idyllic biodynamic system will work on every farm.
Yeah.
But I started with planting the idea, and I'll cultivate that over a few years.
Good. I'll fertilize it
for
you. Another thing that we're growing is these fruit trees that we mentioned. You know, we've got our cider apples that have been planted in small bunches over the last 3 years. We're actually taking cuttings, scions, from our own French heirloom cider apple trees and grafting them little by little every year and then planting out those grafted trees. So we'll plant out about, what is it, I think a 3-acre cider apple orchard, maybe a little smaller than that, over a 4-year period. Again, give us several years, and cider will be a part of the sort of winemaking or value-added program here, which is exciting for the future.
Oh, yeah.
So maybe we'll be in middle school or early high school, so to speak, before we're really have cider be able to bring to the table. But also, I know in our experience on previous farms, the maturity of an orchard takes time, and it takes lots of care.
Mm-hmm.
Care with pruning, consistency of attention, especially when you're growing the diversity of plums, peaches, nectarines, figs, persimmons, cherries, all of these fruits that'll be a part of our system. What I've witnessed is, and it really all starts with the soil health. You know, I'm a little biased here as a soil scientist, of course, but what I see is through those practices you were mentioning of compost, cover crop, animals, animal integration, also not tilling, not disturbing the soil. You know, one big investment we made in a tool this year is to buy a no-till seed drill. And so we'll be able to go into a field, into our cider apple orchard, for example, where we have a stand of cover crop. We planted some perennial and annual rye in there last year. And we want to diversify that, right? We want to add in some more clovers, some oats in there. And we're going to start building that soil health. But getting a little bit off track, my question for you is, what does it take to build a mature orchard that's giving you fruit, good quality fruit, that's maybe not disease, or that's maybe disease free, that sort of thing? What does that actually take to build in this system? And what can we do at this early stage in third grade to be a mature high schooler?
Again, laying the foundation is key. And the best way of approaching Zusu's cider, as using that as the example, where when we want to develop this, you know, just shy of 3 acres of apple trees, our goal is not growing apples. We're not focused on growing a certain amount of bushels per acre to make a certain amount of gallons of cider. Our focus, again, going back to three realms of soil, we get that in balance. Then we start with the right rootstock. We start with the right scion that fits your style of cider.
In this climate,
exactly. Then we focus on having the least amount of inputs on that 3 acres or eventual 3 acres of apple trees as possible. All we're going to add is the biodynamic compost that you guys make on site.
Yep.
We bring in a little bit of kelp meal from off farm, really good biostimulant within the soil. And then we'll use more of the compost teas using your own on farm vermicompost, coupled with off farm kelp, foliar spray. That's 90% of your pest and foliar disease control.
Yep.
We do apply dormant off-season treatments. Three treatments being copper and oil. Some people don't like using copper. We minimize to less than half a pound per year over all the acreage. But my approach would be growing as clean and resilient plant canopy as possible within the first 3 to 5 years. After that, we can start considering fruit.
Yeah.
First We have to grow the plant.
And we went through there this year, and we were really excited to see some cider apples hanging there. And I think it broke everyone's heart to actually thin them off. But I think that's an example of really supporting the tree and the tree's own immune system to really put its energy into foliage and protecting itself, disease suppression, instead of making fruit, which is sort of, it's a way, it's a plant's way to reproduce, right? It's to make a seed. And even though a tree wants to do it, whether it's healthy or stressed out, it's going to make fruit. But if we can actually thin that fruit, we can support the tree in these early years.
And keep it in the vegetative mode.
Yeah.
We're building the scaffold that will allow for you guys to set your cider apples that will then create the cider in your style. First, we have to build the scaffold.
Yeah.
First, we have to build the foundation.
Yeah.
And it's just, you know, you, that's how you end up with a resilient, nutritious, high quality, low quantity harvest that will produce the quality and style that you guys want and look for in your cider.
So quality, let me ask you one more question. So in terms of what you see for the next 5 years of Troon, you know, we talked about expanding the animal program. We talked about the maturity of the orchards coming in. Let's talk about the ecology. Let's talk about those biodiversity reserves. We talked about the challenges of bringing inviting wildlife in. What are the benefits? You know, we've got a native plant garden here with 90 different species of native plants. Mm-hmm. We've got a gorgeous perennial pollinator garden and biodynamic education garden here, and more than 10 acres across all of Troon Vineyard. That is supporting and providing wildlife habitat. As those systems, as those plantings really come into maturity, as well as this tasting room garden that we also just planted this spring, as these systems come into being, what do you see as the benefits for this holistic farm approach?
In an extremely practical level, vines are self-fruitful, don't need pollination, all your plants in your vegetable garden are open pollinated.
Yep.
They need buzz pollination, whether it's a bumblebee or parasitic wasp.
Mm-hmm.
We are building the environment that will support this diverse system out there. And that's, in the next 5 years, you're building that cohesion and that glue of the system that will make the system be resilient, sustainable, and an example of a well-developed, biodynamic, complex farming system.
Yes. Well, I'm really excited for these next 5 years. So thank you so much for joining us today, for joining us every month and guiding us in this journey. Continue to steward us on these next 5 years. I look forward to that. Thank you, Andrew. So, Andrew.
That's a really crappy start.
Okay, well, hold on. Start to introduce yourself, sir.
Okay.